We must protect ourselves from the madness of this world. We must protect our mind from the madness, from the insanity that is at play here. But the question is, how do we do that? Now, in the interest of full disclosure, in order to get through the work week and driving, I'm so tired, I had to drink some Diet Coke. Today I drank about half, just a half, 6 ounces, not much, but it helped me at least perk up a little bit and get through the day. One benefit I find is that I've had a severe problem with, I'm so tired, I have to take a nap when I get back from work, or if I'm not working, just in the middle of the day, I'm so tired. So I'd sleep an hour and a half, 2 hours. What happens is I feel real sluggish for the rest of the day, and then late in the evening, I begin to wake up more. And then when I go to sleep, say like midnight, I wake up at 4 a.m, I can't sleep anymore. This has been going on for like the last 6 months, actually. And it's just brutal. What I found is, if I cannot take a nap in the afternoon or late early evening, then I sleep better. I sleep straight through. So in other words, my sleep schedule is not, sleep clock is not messed up. So paradoxically, when I've a couple of times last several weeks, there's been a couple of times I had to drink a little bit of Diet Coke just to keep from falling asleep while driving. It's been terrible. But what happened was I like slept really, really well after that. So if there's a situation that is so severe that you, like this situation, well, I'm not a fanatic and say, no, you can't touch it, you know, Diet Coke or something. It's not advisable, because then you tend to get irritated or express. What I found is I feel more confident and able to express my how I feel and say, hey, wait a minute, this isn't right. And other people freak out because they're used to me just being a doormat, you see. And so then repercussions come back like, oh, you're crazy. You're a doormat. You know, you're not acting like a doormat like that, you see. So so the we cannot allow the mind to be pulled down into the insanity of this world, actually. But how do we do that? Now today, I had tremendous clarity on all this. Right now, it's I'm in the full stop in the burn mode, and not full stopping very well because of the effects of a little bit of caffeine. I'm not able to make this full stop appropriately. See, this is the problem. This is the problem. As I've said, so I'm a little bit off my game as far as that goes. It's a bad situation. Many people are in bad situations. It's like the walls are all closing in many directions. But even so, today I was able to get a comprehensive overview of the entire situation and see what needs to be done, actually. So I do know what needs to be done. But the struggle right now, the after effects of that is sort of clouding, you know, the picture a little bit. I just have to be patient. And I got a little impatient when you drink a little bit of coffee, but yeah, what, not coffee, Diet Coke. Stay away from coffee, you know, entirely. It's a little bit of Diet Coke is not so severe, but again, it's only an emergency. It should be an emergency measure. So, you know, to say that I was able to see everything that needs to be seen today is a big statement, but it's true. The entrapment of the ego, how we trap ourselves, is very severe. situation in the world is just incredibly terrible. In fact, you might say the world is totally terrible. There's nothing good about it whatsoever. All self-deception. So you either see it that way or you see that it's perfect. There's no two ways about it. As I was able to, you know, work through all of this, it is possible for us to work through this. But the ability to finesse it, you know, when people say this and this and that about it, you know, that takes, you know, absolute calm and peace, which I don't have right at the moment. it's quite something. Everything is perfect, as I've said. Everything's perfect. Why? Because there are no things. And the difference between duality and non-duality is, well, what I said was, when I was driving home, was this dialogue, and the dialogue went like saying, well, is enlightenment sudden or gradual? So this is something the ego's going to ask. And what I ultimately said was, actually, when you're enlightened, when you're liberated from liberation, from desire, it's as if all those problems never were. They never were. So you don't have a sense of accomplishment. You don't have a sense of, I got enlightened. It's as if none of that ever existed, like an ephemeral dream that, you know, when you wake up in the morning, the dreams just kind of disappear and you don't even remember. Did I dream? I don't know. I can't remember anything about the dream. It's more like that. Because I was thinking this morning that, you know, enlightenment is sudden. This is, you know, sudden. This is the morning meditation of sudden. Now I see it's all sudden. But now it's gone even beyond that. And it's, what, you know, what enlightenment is what it's really about. You don't even remember unenlightenment at all. So the idea of, well, how did you get enlightened? That automatically brings back unenlightenment. See how tricky the questions are? The questions of duality are totally tricky, which is why I say communication in this world just reinforces duality. It's totally tricky. Relationships, everything in this world is completely tricky. Remember, these videos are for fourth stage people. Those who are on fourth stage, and not so much for others, actually, because they cannot understand. And they, well, it's more than that. They cannot just be quiet. The way to help people in this world is to help them be quiet. Help them be quiet. I think this is really the only way that someone else can really help another in this world is help them quiet down. Help the mind quiet down. Because only a quiet mind can field the clarity and recognize without acting up too much, you know, what's going on. What does the world need? It needs those who... What people need is to go somewhere and sit with those who are quiet, or have a quiet mind. And that's what can be done in this world. So I know there's ferocious resistance against this, absolutely ferocious resistance. I'm experiencing that today. Trying not to struggle with it. thin delusion. Truth is nothing. Truth, no interest in it whatsoever. So what really needs to happen is someone just put the flag up of a quiet mind and see who salutes the flag, see who comes to, wants to sit by the flagpole, you know. Who wants to sit with quiet mind? That's the question. Because only when you're able to quiet your mind down are you able to recognize these subtleties, this very clever way which you trap, duality traps us, we trap ourselves. So an excited, agitated, hustling, bustling society doesn't have a chance. Doesn't have a chance. And sometimes those who sit in silence and quiet and relative isolation and keep it for a long time, they finally recognize the situation, you know, they recognize it. But even a little bit of quiet mind helps one realize hope, realize hope. Full stop mind. Certainly tell that resistance, the ego, the duality is just really screaming right now. Absolutely. I've got it on the run. So I can explain all I want, but unless someone has a quiet mind, they will not be able to register it properly. The capacity to keep poised, mood of repentance, humble, meek, full stop in the now, the capacity to do that enables the clarity to arise, you're able to see it. Otherwise, it won't be able to see it. So everybody just needs to slow down. Slow down, slow down. The whole world needs to slow down. Slow down. But what's it doing? Faster, faster, faster. It's like the driving here. No, everybody needs to slow down. Is it slowing down? No, everything's going faster. So this is a disaster. There's no way you're going to be able to see the subtlety of what you need to see, the way this culture is going. There is no way. We try to figure out how terrible the world is. There's no end to it. It's completely terrible. And we keep thinking we're going to find something good about the world. Keep digging, keep digging, keep digging. It becomes more and more depressing or shocking, actually. The good is just a way to entrap, helping in order to hurt. Good and bad are actually two sides of one coin. good and evil are two sides of the same coin. Remember, have any knowledge of good and evil? That's two sides of one coin. Not able to deliver a really good video because of the inner agitation of you know, the caffeine does tend to do that. You can't really settle into spiritual discernment. That sort of mimics the burn from inquiry. Sort of mimics the feeling of it to some extent. So you keep waiting for it to subside, and it doesn't subside, and you think you're not making any progress, and you start second-guessing yourself. You know, it's really a very, very nasty trap. So normally, if you're full stop, after a while, all calms down and you're able to move on. If you have caffeine in your system, that feeling, calm, that feeling, it continues and continues. It doesn't dissipate. You say, wow, what's going on? Sort of like an artificial burn feeling, you know, staggered. I saw the world, how it works, and in many videos I've tried to express it, and it's, you know, basically what you'll say is the world's completely wicked, totally wicked, which it is. But again, what's the use of laying out that case? Nobody can understand it. Nobody can handle that unless you're ready to, you know, ready for no enlightenment, to forget about enlightenment, if you really. So, it looks like just before you're ready to forget about enlightenment, you see just how awful the world is. Just delay, just all delay. Championing delay. The unrepentant world is completely wicked, completely wicked. No redeeming features of it whatsoever. Now, to repent is to say, you realize that you cannot express everything, a totality, in words. So you're not demanding To repent means you're not demanding an explanation as the goal. All right? That's another way of defining repentance. Is you understand is beyond what words can convey. Words can never convey a seamless, totally integral totality. Words can never even come close to conveying this. So we realize that that explanation is we're not resting our hopes on explanation. We're using explanation to go beyond, to help us finally go beyond explanation, words to go beyond words. And so we're not argumentative. We're, you know, it's a totally different mood. And rarely does what we find this mood in the world. I certainly don't. Properly aligned expectations. Just that doesn't exist anymore. Hardly. To explain your enlightenment is to keep unenlightenment around, isn't it? Absolutely it is. To explain how you did something is to keep the not doing of it around, really. So the goal is not to get someone to explain truth to you, it's to experience it for yourself. And to experience truth for yourself is to forget all about untruth. Don't really have the foggiest notion about it anymore. So this is the meditation that bears fruit. As to look at it, as I said, no teacher, no student, no explanation. Where you don't no longer have the foggiest notion of untruth. To meditate right at that point, right there. This is crucial, this is key. Now, is there some unforeseen emergency coming in the world? I believe so. I certainly believe so. Do we need to head for the hills? Absolutely. Heading for the hills means exactly what we're doing right now. So instead of, you reach some point where you're no longer trying to explain what's wrong, is you're just simply going and getting ready to forget everything that's wrong. As though it never was. Because it wasn't, actually. It never has been. And then all you can do is to assure others that they can also do this. It's not that you get it and then you explain. There's some explanation they can get, and then they can have some lesser condition than you. Like you're some great teacher, and then they can never reach that. That's nonsense. Real enlightenment inherently frees you from enlightenment. You don't even remember at all what it is you're enlightened about or needed to be enlightened about. So this here is talking about, you know, even more. This is the farthest we've been able to get here. It's another great opening up, a great flowering of truth here. Like awakening from a dream. You know, in a little while, you don't remember waking up from your dream. You don't remember what was in the dream. You don't even remember waking up from the dream. When you're in the middle of your day, are you remembering how you woke up from your dream? Not at all. Not at all. You remember the content of the dream? Probably not at all. Because really the content of our dream is nothing. There's no content. You might say it's just a misperception, a desire to see reality differently than it is. But that reality was never there. The reality is always reality. So there's nothing to fix. Nothing to change, nothing to fix. That's the one thing the ego panics about, is that you can't even explain how you got enlightened at all. You've forgotten completely. That's what the ego's frightened about. That's why the ego wants you to have a path, you see. What if you could say, I don't remember ever having any path whatsoever? Who would get upset about that? The ego gets upset. Our delaying tactics get extremely upset. What do you mean? I put you on this long path, you know, all this stuff, and you don't even remember the path? Of course the ego wants the focus to be on the path, you know, prior to enlightenment, right? Supposedly prior to enlightenment. Of course the ego wants you to explain, but you forget all about it. I don't even remember my path at all, really. Whether I had one or I didn't, it seems like there wouldn't be. How can there be a path? There's nowhere to go. I don't need to go anywhere. Why would I have a path? It's the ego that is actually demanding a path. So we, because we're so afraid of the ego, we're afraid of continuity fear. What we have, our continuity fear, is we pretend like we're on some path. But ultimately, we realize there's never any path. We just called it that to, you know, calm our fears down. So if people can just slow down, slow down, slow down, slow down, drive slower, walk slower, talk slower, do things slower. It's all scary. It's scary. The world's out of whack, out of balance. We used to have a little bit of wisdom in the world. Things are a little more balanced. The breadwinner would go out and have to hustle, come home. And so they need to just, slow down, decompress and slow down. And the homemaker, the housemaker, has a place to slow down, speak slower, talk, you know, do everything. That's calm as a place to calm down. Not anymore, in a lot of instances. And the model for the world is the Silicon Valley here. And I can tell you that that there no longer exists any foundation of slowness here. To be very blunt and just straightforward, you can tell where people are at by the way they drive. And you will find here that the women are driving more aggressively than the men here. Men are driving more crazily. So in other words, if you see someone driving really crazy, it's almost always a man. But in terms of just real quick, aggressive driving, more often than not, is women. Okay, more so than men. Their actions are very speeded up and quick now, very decisive, quick, boom, 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 boom. It's like, wow. I mean, I'm used to saying, look at that guy, what a terrible driver that guy is. You know, I say, wait a minute, let me check and see. Oh my gosh, a woman's driving like that? Wow. It's very unusual. So we're used to women driving calmer, slower, not in so much of a hurry, you know, like that. Not anymore. So people want some foundation that helps bring them down from this manic world. And they're not really getting it, which is why, of course, the purpose of religion is to help us with this. But again, the world is in such a mess, actually, that the answer is not to talk about the mess too much, is to do what we're doing, quiet sitting. Going towards no explanation. This is the key. Now, everyone can go towards no explanation. You're not putting any burden on anyone because no explanation is needed by anyone. So it's not like if you have no explanation, then others have to explain. It's not true. I used to feel that way. I said, wow, Jesus, you're not explaining anything, hardly. And that puts all the burden on me. It's terrible. But there's no burden on anyone to explain what never was. To explain, well, how is it we managed to never do what we never, the impossible? There's no demand for that on anyone. No demand. Zero demand. funny. People do a drastic misread of you, and then they blame you. Well, how come you're not more like my read of you then? It's your fault. This is the craziness of the world. People, you know, completely misread me. And because they don't read, you know, quote unquote enlightenment, non-dual at all. They're not even aware it exists at all. So they can't read what my interest is, where my focus is at all. So they misread and then expect me to live according to their misreading of me. This is the world, isn't it? How terrible is that? Imagine somebody takes you to be a certain way, and then they demand that you be that certain way just so they feel that they're not misreading you. And if you say, hey, you know what, I think you're really misreading me, they get furious, you know, furious, like, how dare you suggest that I'm not reading you properly? Which means, really, how dare you imply that there's something other than duality? How dare you imply that? How dare you imply that there's anything other than worshiping of delay? See, everybody's just tacitly here. Everyone assumes we're all here to worship delay. I mean, the tacit assumption of this world, the way that we're told to view one another, is completely insane. Totally insane. Totally invalid. Yeah, but we're taught this is how you're supposed to view others, and others are supposed to conform to how you view them, and you're supposed to conform to how they view you. And there's this cultural, you know, script of how we view others. And this is what I've been trying to break through my whole life, saying, hey, let's view ourselves in a different way. No. It's not happening. We tried for sure. But the Armageddon of this corporate culture, princess culture, is just devastating everyone. In other words, if you, one way of viewing people, say, what do you think they're thinking about? What do you think they're interested in? What's on their mind? What's important to them, right? That's part of it, right? Has anyone ever viewed me in my interactions in any way even remotely close to what I'm interested in, what's on my mind? No, none. Never. Never. There are some exceptions on this website, on this channel here. There are a few people that tend to view one another, right, saying this is what's probably and they interest them, you know, like that. But, you know, and by and large in the world, people don't view you as anything but completely superficial, basically completely dualistic, inherently dualistic, essentially dualistic. Dualism as the very basis of reality. That's how they view, we were taught to view one another. So it's a crippling, spiritually crippling situation. I saw these videos that some science foundation had set up. It was set up for spiritual questions of scientists. And it used these Tibetan monks. I think they were Gelug monks from the Gelug tradition. I didn't ever pronounce that. From monasteries, they're practicing from monasteries. Presumably, the ones that are now relocated in India, replicated in India, the various famous Gelug monasteries, Sera, and, you know, the other ones, and so. Each video was a monk asking a scientist a question. And all the questions are pretty similar. And they said, hey, you're saying that we're just a brain, you know? And their questions were, so, well, we don't believe that we're just a brain. We believe there's something beyond the brain, for sure. And so they're asking these tricky questions of the scientists, you know? Like, hey, you know, you're viewing us, you're viewing, everyone's being taught to view you as just a brain. You're just a brain, right? Which is true. What they're saying is we've been taught to say we're simply the body, and our consciousness is simply a product of the brain. The brain can produce. There's no consciousness. There's no self that is manifesting a brain. They say it's the brain that is manifesting the self. This is the insanity of modern world, and the monks were pointing this out very politely. I said, oh, you know, how nice to hear that. At least someone somewhere is at least working on this. You know, they have their scholastic, the very order that was a Gelug order has these successive steps that you take, very much so. So they go through this training. They go through this training, and they're trying to questioning the modern paradigm, of course. So basically, everyone in this world is being trained. Almost everyone is being trained to. So they want it to be everyone. They want it to be everyone. Is being trained to view others in a certain way. And this way does not admit for life at all, actually. It's a denial of life. It's a denial of truth. It's a denial of reality. And when you want to see somebody in a truer way, they look at you like, wow, what do you take me for? You're all frightened and freaked out. This is the disease. And you know, another way of expressing this incredible disease in this world right now. Now, spirit keeps its, you know, refuses to repent. A lot of aspects of spirit are unrepentant. And they're looking for excuses, reasons to delay. As I've pointed out in almost all the videos, and they're incredibly intractable. You know, their mind is so intractable. And we'll ask question after question after question after question after question. That's not the way at all. It's delaying tactics. You're trying to keep it at the level of explanation instead of feeling something deeper. Level of words. Here we're just, the words are accompanying what we're feeling. Intensity. The words are just accompanying it. But the real experience is our comfort zone. We're moving our comfort zone. That's the real experience that we're having here. So ultimately, the answer is that what is to be done by all this? There's nothing that needs to be done. And so, if you want to practice, you can practice doing nothing. Of course, your practice implies something more than nothing, doesn't it? So it will seem as though there's a path, but you're really just practicing getting more and more used to doing nothing about it, because there isn't any situation. We ask, what do we do about the situation? Nothing. Ultimately realize there is no situation at all. There nobody is asleep, actually. There's no one asleep. There's no one that's even deluded. No one's deluded, no one's asleep. There isn't anyone to be so. So what do you do to solve all the problems of the world? You don't need to do anything, because there are no problems. And again, all of this is just words just pointing towards the experience beyond the words, moving our comfort zone. This is not an explanation. There's no explanation. We've forgotten what it is that needs to be explained, because there's nothing to explain. Reality simply is. There's no element of explanation to it. We don't say how, we don't have to explain how reality remains as reality, how it manages to avoid not being reality. There's no zero need for any explanation. And so with no explanation to give, because there's absolutely none that needed, then we simply practice sitting quietly and get used to this fact. Now, obviously, this is difficult practice for those who are not prepared for this. They can't do it, actually. I haven't been able to do that until recently. Now I'm able to do it now, but before I couldn't do it. No. No way. My mind would be all upset and agitated and arguing. Well, that's the ego. The ego says, I have to do something, even if it's managing to not do anything. The ego will say, well, how am I managing to not do anything? This is great. You say you're enlightened? Enlightenment? Okay, how am I managing to stay enlightened? How am I managing to not do anything? There isn't any staying enlightened or managing to not do anything or anything like that. Nobody's enlightened. So again, this is fourth phase. Previous phases, this would sound like just psychobabble, just nonsense. But now, it seems like, I can see this very clearly. Wow. It's gospel, you know, it's good news. It's right on the money. This is fantastic. Tremendous. Maybe you ask someone who's quote-unquote enlightened, say, what happened? They say, nothing happened. I say, what do you mean nothing happened? You're so different now. No, I just realized that nothing can ever happen. So I'm at peace with what is, with isness. Nothing can happen. People have a million tactics and a million more and a million more and a million more to delay, to confuse, delay, all clever tactics. And what do you do about them? Nothing. Nothing needs to be done. Nothing needs to be done about anything. There isn't anything. The key is to just keep getting used to this, even though we may not be able to like see it. Like right now, I can't see it clearly, but I know it's true. So I keep saying it and getting used to it. Getting used to it. Like if you're saying God, 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 you may not be tuning, feeling God every time you say God, but you know there is this sense of God. So you keep saying it, you're appealing to God, you're appealing to God. So just keep saying it, even though you may not be entirely clear about why you're doing it. Don't need to explain. Mentality of the flesh, you know, it's just delay. It's all it is, 100% delay. It's delay in realizing there never was any flesh. There is no situation, there is no condition. No such thing as conditions in reality. If the weather, for example, if the weather could be whatever you want it to every instant, how can you say, talk about the weather? So you see what we're saying here? How can you say, well, it's going to be cloudy today with a blah? How can we even say that? That's ludicrous, right? And how can someone say, well, I just sure hope we can clear up this cloudy weather, make it nice and sunny? That's ludicrous. There is no weather. If you control instant by instant exactly what you're experiencing, for example, not just everything, but everything and including the weather. Let's use the weather as an example. Can we say, oh, the weather is warm? Is this warm weather we're having? No, there's no warm weather. Because that implies a determinate continuation, a determinate continuity between this instant and the next. And you're taking out, spirit's taken out of the equation. Now it says there's something called weather that is determining what you're experiencing. Same thing with the body. We say the body is determining what we're experiencing. But the body is just an instant by instant appearance that we're desiring. There's no determinate continuity of a body, of a thing, of weather, of anything. There's no determinate continuity whatsoever. Nothing is causing anything except our desire to experience. What we call cause and effect, materialistic cause and effect, is a play of light, of appearance. There's nothing actually being caused at all. Now, we've agreed on various conventions of appearance to give the illusion of causation. Like gold is always gold, you know, the atomic arrangement, this, all these things. But there's no determinant continuity anywhere, ever. So how can we speak of the weather? Now, Tibetans have this word Rigpa, which is like pure awareness, which is apparently seeing everything without determinant continuity. Buddhism says something about dependent arising or something, dependent arising. Meaning there's just one appearance each moment. But there are no things, there are no independent things at all. From the standpoint of appearance, there's no determinant continuity whatsoever. The thing is that light has been frozen down. Go so slow here that it gives the illusion of determinate continuity, especially through sensory perception. So we can say, what happened, enlightenment or something. Well, you can say it's a rigpa, this is a rigpa, this is a viewing, dependent arising with no determinate continuity. And people say, okay. I don't know, it may be helpful to put the situation in terms of Tibetan Buddhism, because that's so acceptable around the world. It's the darling of the world, really, right? It's kind of like we're all mothers to the Tibetan people, because, you know, they got kicked out of their country. I mean, how many monasteries did they have, hermitages, both for men and women there? Young people too, from what age, 8 to 80, 70 or something, but they had like 6,000 monastic retreats and all over Tibet. It's amazing. When the Chinese came in, by the time they got done, was how many were left? 8, I think. They had 8. 8. Now maybe there's been some rebuilding a little bit since then, but see, from 6,600 or 6,000 was whatever to 8, the others were demolished, destroyed, defaced, ruined. You know, so had to flee their country. They've been going through all these hardships, and so the world has adopted them kind of like as, you know, hey, these are our orphan, you know. Foster children or foster brothers and sisters or something. So nobody's going to say anything bad against the Tibetans, you know. So if you say, yeah, I thank you, Jesus, for giving me salvation. You know, if you say that now, where people, like, you know, pull out the white jackets, call 911, essentially. You know, we got this 911 consciousness. You can call this world 911 consciousness. It's pretty interesting, right? That 9/11 happened and we've all gone into a 911 consciousness. I'm not talking about the World Trade Center. I'm talking about calling 911 on your phone emergency, saying, hey, I got a severe problem here. Help, paramedics, fire, police, everyone come. There's some. So if you say, oh my gosh, people say, what happened? Saved by the grace of Jesus Christ, I've been, you know, liberated from the delusion. You know, I'm full of the love of Jesus Christ, and people call 911. If I went around my town saying that downtown and wherever, in any store, you know, telling people, hey, you know, God loves you, Jesus loves you, you know, I guarantee you that about 99.99% of the people would be reaching for their smartphones to call 911. Absolutely. So nobody's doing that. Wouldn't even think of it. You didn't think of it, you stomp on that thought. So you're gonna be called a loony. You know, you're gonna be taken to the loony bin. But if you say, well, I'm practicing some Tibetan, some wonderful Tibetan gelugs, which is the Dalai Lama. I'm not sure how to pronounce that. I have to look that up. But the yellow hats, Dalai Lama yellow hat, that transmission line of Tibetan Buddhism is primarily focused on the compassion, with the Mahayana compassion. That's why every time you see the Dalai Lama and those that are in that lineage, they're always saying for the compassion, compassion for the compassion, everybody, compassion, compassion. This is actually a cultivation of bodhicitta. It's part of the greasing the structure of delusion so that you can simply let it go. It's part of the training. It's part of the training. So that's what you always get. It's all compassion, compassion. So you just say, well, I'm just doing a practice of compassion. Oh, where'd you get that? Oh, the Dalai Lama, suggest. Oh, that's great. Wow, can you come over to our house and place and can you help us with this? Yeah, that's great. Because it's fashionable, you see. It's fashionable. And people, certainly, the insane intolerance of this world towards non-duality, nobody wants to admit it because they don't want to admit how the severity of their continuity fear is so severe they don't want to even admit it at all. So they have to pretend like they're all for, spiritual truth. Of course we're for it. So they need to have some fashion that they can say, they used to talk about Jesus, they'll call 911, but if you say Dalai Lama, they say, oh, yeah. Oh, God. Wonderful, 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 yeah. Nice, wonderful, compassionate, wonderful. Okay, that's it. But see how that is in the world? It's very, very, very funny, this world. Very, it's a lunatic asylum. And that's putting, it's being very kind to say it's a lunatic asylum, insane asylum. Very kind indeed. It's actually completely vicious, this world. Out of terrible fear. And don't think the history of Tibet has been all peaceful. It has not at all. It has not at all. I mean, the Yellow Hats came to power by allying with the Mongols, I mean, they were head crackers. And, tough stuff. Tough stuff. A lot of political, a lot of infighting, religious infighting. And, oh boy, intrigues and the whole nine yards. I think Longchenpa actually had an assassination attempt on him by some other rival group or something there, religious group. Barely and miraculously escaped with his life. Had to flee to Bhutan, I believe. Tons of assassinations in Tibet and violence and attack and infighting and intrigue and drama. The whole nine yards, the whole nine yards. But we won't talk about that now. The thing is, if you say, oh, yeah, I've attained what's called Rinpa, which is, the awareness of determinant arising, which is, determinant arising, the absence of determinant continuity. It's the absence of determinant continuity and the realization of just one determinant arising, as, it's taught in Tibetan teachings and stuff like that, Dalai Lama, I think he'd understand that. Oh yeah, of course, yeah. That's great. I'd say, look at you like, that's great. Then it's like, oh yeah, I'm not gonna talk with him anymore. I don't want to see that person again. They shun you, they'll be completely shunned, But at least they won't call 911. Yeah. Maybe I don't know. Maybe the Tibetans are going around saying, "Don't say you got a Rinpa. Don't say that because it'll give us a bad name." We don't want anyone to think that we're actually succeeding. Because maybe they'll turn against us. We just want to. It'd be colorful amongst, debating and doing all this debate, okay, you got it right, like that. And doing these poses and stuff that have meanings, of course, all the stuff has all gestures have meaning about the intensity of the debate, who's winning and losing, whether you made a point or something. This is part of the Gelug tradition. And it's very colorful, and so people see it and say, wow, this is very ethnic, I'm very cosmic, I'm very worldly, very have a world culture outlook. I have a global outlook here. So people, you know, they have to have a global outlook here. So anything that appeals to this global outlookness is like, they'll say, yeah, that's good, that's good, that's good. You're paying attention to that. Yeah, that's good stuff. Yeah. I gotta be more global myself too, you know. I'm working on it. I got some friends. I know somebody has an exchange student from Tibet or something. Yeah, we're trying to be more global too. Interesting culture. Those people, yeah, interesting culture. This is the situation. If you talk about Jesus, they automatically assume, oh, my God, one of those wingnut, radical, conservative wingnuts, complete lunatics. We already have figured out that they have a problem in their brain, and better get start treating them right away. It's like complete paranoia here in the United States. Absolute religiophobic Jesus paranoia. Nazarene paranoia. The Nazarene paranoia syndrome. They're suffering from NPS. Doctors get on the commercials and say, are you suffering from, do you have feelings of fear and intimidation when someone mentions the term Jesus? Do you feel uncomfortable when people are talking about religion? Are you feeling like you want to ostracize those who hold religious viewpoints? If you're experiencing these and other allied symptoms, you may be suffering from NPS. The good news is NPS is treatable. In fact, we're doing clinical trials right now. If you may be suffering from NPS, give us a call. And perhaps you can join our clinical trials. We have a very promising treatment for NPS right now. Yes. You may have NPS, Nazarene Paranoia Syndrome. Of course, people are always looking for new illnesses to have, so maybe this is the way to go too. Just point out to me, I have this called, yeah, it's called Nazarene Paranoia Syndrome, and but it's treatable. Sometimes this happens, you see, especially when you're under stress. Yeah. You see, the modern people are very embarrassed about their history of religious history, you know, last two, very embarrassed about it. They're mortified. And they say, I didn't have any relatives back then. No. Yeah. Oh, my. So they don't even want to think about it or talk about it. It's just like, they feel, my God, you know, how stupid we were back then, they're saying. How incredibly bigoted and prejudiced and intolerant and unenlightened we were. So it's just something they shrink away. Is this the Nazarene paranoia syndrome? Oh my God. Or you say CPS, Christian paranoia syndrome. So are you suffering from CPS? My friend, are you suffering from CPS? We're gonna have a walk. We're gonna find a cure, a walk for the cure. We're gonna have a ribbon. What kind of ribbon are we gonna wear? Maybe a blue ribbon or something. Walk for a cure. Let's walk for the cure for CPS or CPS syndrome. Terrible disease, sweeping the planet. Awful consequences. Rebirth. Remember, Dharma is just all the skillful means you use to make sure you don't get free, make sure you get free from rebirth. That's what the Dharma really means. Buddha said, practice the Dharma. What does he mean? All skillful means, ways, practices, focus of attention, discipline, etc., that frees you from rebirth. That's the Dharma. Hello. Hello, Dharma. DPS, Dharma Paranoia Syndrome, CPS. You suffer from CPS, DPS, and NPS. Sort of a collective, massive syndrome. They even put the llamas in commercials. You know, maybe they'll have them selling detergent or I think razors, detergent or something. They're climbing the Himalayas, and there's a llama there, Geshe, Rinpoche, various Tulku, Gompa, whatever, all the different things, degrees of attainment, different abbots. You know, different. They have a word for every degree of attainment. Sitting up there in meditation. Top of a mountain, the seeker comes up there, and the lama says, "Why are you coming up here? You've already got the product back where you live. Come on." "Oh, I do. Yeah, you just need to buy this." "Oh, thank you, lama." So they're even, you know, it's even okay to use them in commercials. Use them, you know. Yeah, but walk for the cure. Let's have a walk for the cure. Concert for the cure. Let's have a concert to cure Christian Paranoia Syndrome, CPS. CPS. Or Christ Paranoia Syndrome. Nazarene Paranoia Syndrome, NPS. So, until there's a cure. It's worse than cancer, way worse than cancer, because this paranoia syndrome results in rebirth. Results in rebirth. What could be worse than rebirth? Rebirth is subjecting yourself to all the ills and suffering and misery that befalls a body. All of them, not just cancer, everything. Worrying about everybody else's health. Everybody you're dependent on, everybody you feel fondly towards, everybody just in general, your friends, you feel that way friendly to everybody in the world, I sure do. And you worry about all of them. I worry about everybody's health and well-being. Everybody. Even, yeah, without any exception. Absolutely. I want everybody to be perfectly happy, just as I want myself to be perfectly happy. Without exception, I don't need to even think about it. This is part of the bodhicitta, bodhicitta, whatever. May all beings experience, you know, experience bliss. May all beings be liberated. May all beings, you know, that's a practice, a conscious practice of one of the paths there. And others don't emphasize that as much. Just same thing like Seva, you know, the Indian teachings of do good for everyone, serve everyone as if they were, you know, God, and treat everyone, you know, Christian, do unto others as you would have them do unto you. You know, it's all the same. It's all the same stuff. Cultivate compassion. So absolutely, I wish pure happiness this very instant upon everybody. See, this is the key, this very instant. Because if you put it in the future, you're saying, well, you know, I hope some of them get suffer really bad before they get to pure happiness. I'm going to give them opportunity to really get cancer or something, you know. But if you say this very instant, pure happiness to everyone, pure happiness to everyone, then you're not asking them to suffer, are you? No. you have CPS Awareness Month, actually. I need to, like, drop a calendar, you know, and start putting stuff on the calendar. Need to, you know, the way you really advance, one of the ways is you make your own calendar, actually. These are your festivals, these are your days, these are, you know, and structure your year based on that calendar. Called liturgical calendars, I mean, Catholics put one out. Have all the feast days of all the saints in their calendar, all the whole year structured, you know, around the cycles of the church, and this is how people stay on track. You know, this is a spiritual discipline, so we can make a calendar. Absolutely possible to do something like that. Printable calendar. What if there's such a thing online? A printable calendar. Just set something up. You know, it may not go much further past July 2016, though. Is the problem. I think I said this in another video, but I'll say it again. I was coming to an intersection, and this van on my left, and this right was green, and this van suddenly slowed down, like, whoa, and then, like, looking like this. So I saw that. I said, whoa, it must be some emergency vehicle coming down the road or something. And so I stopped, and I looked. I didn't see anything. And even though I didn't see anything, I didn't go. I said, wait a minute. Well, what am I not seeing? What am I missing? I must be missing something. And I guess there wasn't anything there, but... I look, it was an Indian lady, an old Indian lady driving the van. I said, that's weird. It's unusual. This whole thing's unusual. I felt this feeling like this is telling me something. What's going on? Well, maybe this is symbolizing something that there is an emergency. I just can't see it. But she saw it somehow, right? Like that. Meaning the old Indian lady representing maybe Ananda Mahima, saying, hey, I see the emergency. You can't see it, but I see it. You better slow down. And she's looking towards the hills. She may be saying, but you need to head for the hills. It's time to head for the hills. Heading for the hills means get out of trouble. Get distance. Distance yourself from trouble. What this world is teaching is entitlement complex. Entitlement complex. Now, it's very important to listen to this entitlement complex. The entitlement complex says that they should get the results from the highest teaching just because they're entitled to it, without doing any of the work, without doing any of the preparation, without dealing with the continuity fear at all. They say, hey, is there something good to get? Okay, well, we're entitled to it. So, and... if they don't get it, they say, well, you have to give it to me. I'm entitled to have the... if you're happy, you got happiness. Well, I'm entitled to it, too. So, where is it? Come on, give it to me. So those who are truly happy, they say, well, you need to share it with us because we're entitled to it. And I say, well, the only way you get it is you have to work through your continuity fear. And they say, no, I don't have to do that. I'm entitled to it. So this is what's going on in the world. There's the building up of what's called an entitlement complex, which is all about skipping phase 1, 2, 3, and 4 and going straight to phase 5 without ever doing anything about the continuity fear, evaporating it at all. Okay, now this is, you know, the heart of resistance, of delusions. This is the terrible situation in this world. And there's people are getting enslaved by those